Okay, I'm going to tell you now about one of my very favorite experiments, which is that we're getting very young babies to tell us where they hear sounds, but it's in the dark. So these babies are 6 months old, and they're not scared of the dark yet. So you can bring them into the lab, and you turn the light off every time you present a sound, and we have an infrared camera looking down on them and recording them, okay? So what you're looking at, so what we're teaching them to do is to reach for the sound, because what they want to do every time they hear a sound or something interesting is going on is they want to manipulate the object, right? They hear, they want to bring it to understand what it is, they want to suck on it, right? When they're 6 months old, they manipulate with their mouth. So we're using this reaching in the dark as a way to measure what's going on. In the early studies, when we did this in the 80s, when I was in graduate school, it was simple. We put popcorn in a box, and we shook it, and that made a rattle sound. And we attached, everybody remember Big Bird? Big Bird was just, they loved it. And we attach it with Velcro to the box, and they knew that if they found it in the dark, they were allowed to take it off and play with it. And that was the reinforcer. They didn't need a movie, they didn't need a bouncing toy. That was enough. Nowadays, we use loudspeakers, and we give them stickers and food and other things. But, you know, basically, you gotta reinforce them, okay? So now you're looking at a picture through the infrared camera, and there is the bald head of a baby. And these are his little arms reaching in front, and he's touching the object. And this is just his mom's hands holding his waist so he doesn't go flying forward. And in front of him is where the different sounds can come from. So here's where that Big Bird came from, and he reached for it. But now let's look at it from a side angle. So you can see that the sound is coming toward him, and he can hear it. His little arm comes up. It gets closer, and the arm is coming up further. And now he brings the other hand in for reinforcement. And he takes the toy, and now he's happy. And what we've discovered is that babies will do this many times because they have fun with it. And in fact, I'm showing you some results, which is that most of the time, they're correct. So they're doing a very good job of localizing those sounds. Sometimes they're not correct. Sometimes there's no response, but they're pretty good at telling us. So we've devised a very fun game for them. Now, one thing that I think is important for me to mention is that one of the leading causes of hearing loss is noise exposure. And so I love to tell that to my students who plug iPods into their ears and I can hear them from 5 feet away. I'm like, bring that sound down, right? Or you're sitting next to somebody on the airplane and they have the thing blaring. Or people, you know, in some workplaces, or, you know, sometimes children go to those very, very loud environments, what we think are fun and stimulating, but in fact they're very loud. And so I think that it's important for us to recognize the dangers that come with, not just once, but if you spend your life, if you spend many hours over a long period of time, you will see hearing loss. And so I think it's really important to start at a very young age training and teaching our children to protect their hearing. And you can never start too young. Just like you protect the rest of your body, it's good to protect your hearing. And we forget about our hearing because we don't see what's going on inside the head so much. So we forget about it sometimes. Now, I mentioned to you cochlear implants, which are provided to children and adults who are deaf. I'm showing you a picture here of a very unique family. So typically, cochlear implants are provided to adults who have lost their hearing, but they're used to be able to hear. Or children who are born deaf or identified at a young age as being deaf. This family is unusual because both mom and dad were born deaf, grew up with sign language and lip reading. They had two children who are deaf and decided to give them implants. And what's interesting is they decided right away to give each child one implant in each ear because they'd been reading about the literature showing that with two implants, you get better ability to hear in noisy environments, to function in your classroom, and to know where sounds are coming from. And then each parent got an implant as an adult. And they can't use their implant that well to be able to understand speech, but they love that it helps them lip read, and they love that they know what their children have gone through. So the household has six implants, which is a lot of technology to take care of, but they really are a fascinating family, and they're bilingual. They sign, they use sign language, and they speak. And what's fascinating is when I hear the children speak, I don't know that they've grown up in a deaf household because they've had so much speech therapy and so much rehabilitation and training that they're able to produce speech like almost like typical normal hearing children. And so that's a testament to the technology, to the parents' hard work, and to the children's hard work at their therapy. They go about 7 hours a week, which is a lot of work, but they've really succeeded in that. What I want to do is give you a little sense of what the cochlear implant does, because we do a lot of work with it. I personally don't tell people that I think they should get implants. I'm just always happy to answer questions. So I don't want you to think I'm advocating for this. I also advocate for the deaf community and for choices that people make. But for people who choose to get cochlear implants, I think it's a very interesting technology because it can allow someone who wants to function in the hearing world access to sound through electrical hearing. But I also want you to appreciate that they have to work very, very hard to hear through this technology. So it's not as if we turn a switch and all of a sudden you get beautiful, perfect hearing. I want you to listen to what is my computer simulation of what it sounds like to listen through a cochlear implant, especially in the early stages. So what we're doing is we are stimulating the auditory nerve with a bunch of electrodes that are sitting in that organ, the cochlea that I showed you. So now we're putting these electrical signals directly in the cochlea, sending sounds up to the brain. This is a picture of a little baby with their implant, which is the speech processor here, picking up the signal and sending it to their head. And what I'm going to do is play a sound. I'll hold the microphone to it. And this is somebody saying a sentence, a girl saying a sentence, and you'll probably have a hard time understanding it because it's degraded. The cochlear implant only has a few number of what we call frequency channels, so it's degraded. And as we add more information, it's a little easier for them to understand. But the most important thing is the experience, brain plasticity, and learning how to use these signals. So listen to it and see if you understand what she's saying. Could you hear that? Or maybe I should hold this microphone to it. Could you hear that? Let me try it again. Does anybody understand that? Okay. Let's add a few more information channels. It's going to get a little easier. A little easier. Okay, let's add some more information.
Wanna come to my birthday party in August? Wanna come to my birthday party in August?
And here's the natural speech. Now let's listen to the original degraded signal. See if you understand it now that you know what you're hearing. Did it pop out? Yeah. So what happens is that the signal is degraded, which means that we can't have tens of thousands of information channels like in the normal acoustic system. So we can only put a few channels of information in. It's degraded, but because they're working so hard to put together the world, the sensation, the cognition, the perception, they learn how to use the signal, and they get so much better at it that they can even produce normal hearing speech. So it's really, really remarkable.